Good evening and welcome to Freedom is a Constant Struggle with your host Kilu Nyasha and board opping is Jackie Perez. Today we're going to focus on homelessness, and the homelessness has become a critical issue here in California, which has the largest homeless population in the country at this point. Roughly 7,000 homeless people in San Francisco alone, and there are only about 1,200 shelter beds. So we're going to go straight to a video before I introduce my guest, who is the executive director of the Coalition on Homelessness in San Francisco, Jennifer Friedenbach. But before I introduce her, we're going to go to a very short video that focuses on the homeless in San Francisco.
Welcome to KQED Newsroom. I'm Thuy Vu. On our show, efforts to stop human trafficking and teaching engineering through play. But first, the Super Bowl and the city's homeless. Next week, worldwide media will descend on San Francisco to cover the Super Bowl. Activists are planning protests to draw attention to the issue of homelessness. It's long been one of San Francisco's most intractable problems, now highlighted by encampments that seem to be growing. Reporter Monica Lam takes a closer look.
It's a daily routine. City crews across San Francisco clean up around homeless encampments. Every day, a ton of trash is swept up, scrubbed away, and hauled off.
My friend, is there any other things you would like to get rid of?
The city says it doesn't take personal property or force anyone to move. But David Tompkins says when the cameras aren't rolling, things are different.
I mean, they've been shoving us around like ping pong balls.
Just in general, does anyone come and hassle you?
Tell no,
you
nobody
you
got... asks us to move. They tell us to move. They start taking our stuff. I woke up to all these guys throwing my things in the garbage.
Tompkins is a carpenter who lost his home several years ago. Now he offers to build homes on wheels for others on the streets.
And I'll build one for anyone free. All they got to do is ask me.
The city estimates some 3,500 people make their home on the streets.
My name is Rebecca Padilla. I'm 34, and I've been out here for about a year.
Padilla lives in a tent under the busy 101 freeway.
Moved over this way because I had a few friends here. It was better than being by myself. We have our good days and bad days, I guess, just like normal people.
Padilla says the others who live on this strip of sidewalk are like her family.
It's all pretty hard. I guess the hardest thing is making sure you don't lose yourself and giving up hope. Tell you the truth, when I put up my Christmas tree for everybody, I called it the Tree of Hope. Because what else you got?
With a Super Bowl around the corner, Padilla worries life could get harder.
That's because we were told that we had to move from the area because of the Super Bowl. The mayor doesn't want all this to be seen by the, you know, the public eye.
In August, Mayor Ed Lee was widely quoted as saying the city's homeless would have to leave the streets before the Super Bowl.
So here are the different dorms.
Sam Dodge, the mayor's appointee to tackle homelessness, says the mayor's remarks were blown out of proportion.
There's no formal city policy or no instructions given to cops to move people for the Super Bowl. The real thing that we're concerned with right now is El Nino and people's health.
I'm in the process.
The city has about 1,200 shelter beds year-round. For the rainy winter months, they're looking to double that number. I'm standing in front of one of the city's temporary rain shelters. It's inside that building behind me and will be open if the weather is bad enough. But many of the homeless people I talk to complain that shelters are dirty, dangerous, and only a short-term solution.
they just let you stay in their shelter for a week or two, and then they throw you back out on the street. So it's like, why put yourself through that? Get comfortable in a bed somewhere just to go right back out onto the street. That's just torture of another torture.
Yes. All right. Welcome.
Thank you.
Yeah, get warm, rest up.
Okay.
Marin Santi just moved into the city's Navigation Center, a new long-term shelter that opened last year.
That's Teddy. And that's Teda. And this is Puppy.
Unlike other shelters, this center allows homeless people to move in as a group and with their pets. And they can stay as long as it takes to find permanent housing.
I'm so glad you're in there, man. Hey, congratulations.
Thank you.
Good to see you.
At 38 years old, Santi says she's been on the streets since she was 11.
In and out of group homes. But I never stayed long because I was always paranoid. I have bad paranoia, schizophrenic.
Santi says living on the streets makes it hard to avoid breaking the law. According to the city, last year, police handed out about 2,300 citations a month, or 77 a day, for offenses such as sleeping in the park, blocking a sidewalk, or drinking in public. When the citations pile up, offenders are taken to jail. Santi says she's been jailed 3 times.
They've taken my tent. They've put my dog in jail. I have no clothes, no tent. They've taken everything I've owned.
Including, Santi says, her medications for HIV.
My police colleagues tell me all the time that they want more real solutions. That people need a housing. They need a place to go.
But housing in the Bay Area is already in short supply. Home prices and apartment rents keep climbing, and building affordable housing can take years.
What would it take to end homelessness in San Francisco?
Yeah, ending homelessness is a matter of both resources and political will and public support.
While homeless encampments now seem to be everywhere, the annual homeless count suggests only a small growth in actual numbers. Some city officials say it's widespread development that's now pushing the homeless into more visible spaces.
Over the last 10 years, our homeless count has stayed relatively stable. Now, that's a kind of success, but it doesn't feel like success to me, and I know it doesn't feel like success to those experiencing homelessness or citizens of our city. We really need to do better.
David Tompkins thinks he knows why the homeless problem persists.
So who wants to tackle a problem that's in public office with no fix?
But Santi says she is now optimistic about her future.
I'm hoping to get into some kind of SRO housing.
As for Rebecca Padilla, she has just one wish.
Making it out of this, that's for sure. Because I would love to be with my son again. My son's my pride and joy. He's 10 years old. I don't want him to see me out here like this. But he knows.
And we're back with Jennifer Friedenbach. And Jennifer, originally from Redwood City, has worked more than 25 years on homeless and poverty issues, including welfare rights, housing, homeless prevention, healthcare, disability, and human and civil rights. For 5 years, Jennifer worked at San Mateo County's Hunger and Homeless Action Coalition, moving from administrative assistant to director. She started working in San Francisco 14 years ago with the coalition. She served on the Implementation Council for the 10-year plan to end chronic homelessness and was a founding member of the People's Budget Collaborative, which redirects city funding toward supporting poor people's programs in San Francisco. Jennifer has co-authored a number of reports, including Locked Out, The Voices of People with Mental Illness, a 1999 study citing bureaucratic blockage of access to San Francisco's mental health system for people in crisis. Another publication, Housing First for Families, which documents the impact of homelessness on children, and Shelter Shocked, which presents a statistical study of human rights abuses in San Francisco's shelter system. In 2014, Jennifer was among 11 San Franciscans honored with the Women Making History Award. Welcome to Freedom, Jennifer. It's such a pleasure to have you back.
Thanks for having me.
Yes, yes. You do such great work, and you're so informed, well-informed. So let's talk about, I mentioned earlier that there are roughly 7,000 homeless in San Francisco, that's a bit of a drop, right?
Yeah. I mean, it's an undercount because it's a one-night count. And the way they do it is they look at people and try to tell by looking at them whether they're homeless or not, and then count people that way. And so, of course, they miss a lot of people that are invisible homeless. And so families with kids and, different folks who don't just, appear homeless. And so they're going to do another one this January. They do one every other year. But it does give us an opportunity to compare apples to apples because they do it the same way every other year.
Okay, so what is your estimate of the number of homeless families and individuals in San Francisco now?
Well, we have the counts about 7,000. We know there's about 4,000 kids that go through at least, the main homeless youth provider, Larkin. We know we have at least 3,000 homeless children in San Francisco. So we don't usually do our own estimates, but, it's clearly much higher than the homeless count.
I see. And I understand that there are only about 1,200 shelter beds.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's certainly not going to accommodate everyone.
Yeah, even with the more conservative count, it's about one shelter bed for every 5.5-6 homeless people.
Right. So what are the people, first of all, it's my understanding that people really don't like the shelters. Can you explain why?
Well, it's not even an issue because the shelters are always full. Today we have 1,009 people on the wait list for shelter. So it's, it reached our, went over the 1,000 mark on Monday, and it keeps climbing. For a lot of folks, it's very difficult living in congregate settings. You're sleeping with a big group of people, and that can be difficult. So all the stuff, all the society's oppressions and, different things that we have going on are, of course, reflected in a shelter. So you're going to have folks who are homophobic. You're going to have folks who are... really nice. You're going to have people who are jerks. You're going to have, all of that because you're all sleeping together in this shared space. So
I understand there's a problem with people losing their stuff and people getting ripped off.
There is. I mean, it depends on the, a lot of the shelters have like a locked place that you can keep your stuff. There is problems with theft. Mm-hmm. I think there's problems with theft out on the street too. Mm-hmm. So it's, it can happen, but, it's sort of a moot point because there's tons of people who are trying to get shelter that would be, grateful just to have a place to get some rest,
right.
That are unable to because the wait lists are so long. The city does underfund the shelters, so there's a big struggle there. The staff are underpaid, and there's a lot of staff that do really good work, and there's a lot of staff that get stressed out and really, are working multiple jobs, and that's reflected in how they're acting day to day.
And how they treat the homeless.
Yeah, it's, how they treat other people, of course,
right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, there have been these homeless sweeps. Like, I've often complained about the fact that when I roll down 16th Street coming to the studio, there's a whole slew of tents and people living in these tents on the street,
you know,
where there are no storefronts. And I understand that the police have been sweeping people away and confiscating their things and all that. But I understand that recently there was a judge who decided to stop doing that and put a stop to it. And
well, so there's a couple things that have happened. There has been some legal challenges. There's been legal challenges on a number of different fronts. So there's been a bunch of legal challenges on the property confiscation. Right now, San Francisco is being challenged by the ACLU and the Lawyers Committee about their property confiscation practices, and they have a lot of information from homeless people and caught on videotape and all this stuff about that. And so they're in negotiations about having a policy. There's cases in Fresno, cases in a bunch of different places that were successful there. There's now a lawsuit against Caltrans, who's also taking people's property. There was a
Caltrans?
Yeah,
What are they doing taking people's property?
Well, the CHP, California Highway Patrol, in conjunction with the Caltrans properties. So they're the patrol for the property there. And so they take a lot of, they're particularly notorious for taking people's property, and they're sort of a famous, you know, picture that had been floated around the internet of them taking a man's walker and putting it in the crusher. And it was a homeless vet. And the other things that happened, there was a Du Bois lawsuit that the Obama administration weighed in on. That lawsuit wasn't successful, but the Obama administration has put out guidelines, and they basically say you need to offer housing to people if you're going to, it's cruel and unusual punishment if you just force people to move when they have nowhere to go. And the guidelines suggest that they have temporary, if you don't have permanent housing for them, you have temporary housing that's going to lead into permanent housing, and that there's a full relocation plan and a thoughtfulness about how they address the sweep. So this past year, of course, as you know, your audience saw on the initial part of the video, we had the Super Bowl that was going on, and Mayor Ed Lee made comments about homeless gotta go. Contrary to what the city official said, there was policy, because that same city official was engaged in offering those navigation beds that he was standing at to people who were camped at the Super Bowl. And so folks who were in the Super Bowl site got priority above people who were on a long wait list for those navigation centers. So they dealt with trying to remove people by offering them navigation centers to the detriment of others.
Who had been on long waiting lists.
They were on long waiting lists. They pushed people, you know, out of all the central corridors into the city. A lot of the police were pushing people towards Division Street. So there was that situation happening where on Division, we ended up with about 300 campers there. And then the city, you know, instead of kind of a thoughtful process of trying to figure out a relocation plan for those folks, after three editorials in the Chronicle calling for them within a you know, 48-hour period, calling for them to get rid of the encampments, including one by former Mayor Willie Brown, they just went in and very haphazardly ended up removing the entire encampment. Of course, at that point, they didn't have a place for people to go. They were planning on having to move to Pier 80, which is the shelter, but they only had 20 beds open, and it wasn't at full capacity. So the whole thing was a total boondoggle, and a lot of folks lost their property, a lot of confiscation that happened there. And so that's kind of like the big one with all the news cameras, and that was caught by a lot of folks. But of course, every day there's sweeps, small and large, that are happening where the police are asking people to move. DPW is asking them to move to clean. They're permanently removing people. People are being moved a block away. You know, this we're talking to folks constantly that, you know, they were behind Best Buy in the Mission, and then, you know, they were told to move a block away, and then a few days later they're told to move from there, and so they're just on this constant march with no way out.
Right.
So yeah, and the city's been kind of trying to do something different. They're doing these encampment resolution team where they're identifying encampments mostly driven by complaints, you know, areas that are generating a lot of complaints from neighbors, a lot of new neighbors that have moved in, and they are saying we want these folks out of here. The city is trying to offer them temporary accommodations like substance abuse treatment or temporary accommodations at the navigation center, like a 30-day stay there, and then asking them to be removed and then telling the neighbors to call the police if the homeless people come back. And so that's their kind of newer, kinder, gentler way of approaching the encampments, but they're not offering people permanent housing.
Right. And so I understand that there's a $30 million plan.
Well, no, to house homeless families.
It's a public-private partnership with $20 million already in the bank, and they say city officials and philanthropists all but guaranteed success despite the challenges.
Yeah, they're hoping to raise $30 million. They've so far raised $11 million,
okay.
Although they're kind of counting other stuff in there that was, you know, already going on. But my understanding is $11 million that they've raised so far, and I just met with those folks today. And what the money is paying for, since it's philanthropy, and not government money, it's one-time money. So with one-time money, you can only do certain things. You can.
I thought there was a public-private partnership. The government's not kicking in anything?
No, they're not. They are. The money's actually going directly to a nonprofit. The city is you know, I mean, they're doing other stuff for homeless families that they're already doing, but I think it's a public-private partnership in that the mayor's making the announcement and the mayor kind of negotiating the deal and all that kind of stuff, but it's temporary. So it's temporary subsidies, like 18-month housing subsidies. For most of the families, they're small subsidies. The only way they work for most of the families is to send them out of town. So about 75% of the families who will use the subsidy will go out of town. They're hoping to house 800 people if they raise the $30 million. You know, they have the $11 million now, so it's, you know, not all the way there. So, you know, hopefully they can house a couple hundred families, but it's temporarily and out of town, which, of course, most of the families are African-American. We have a lot of problem with sending African-Americans outside of San Francisco and displacing them. The whole fabric of the community ends up disintegrating. The families are in areas where there's no economic opportunity. They're way out in the suburbs, the Antiochs, these kind of places. They don't have grandma nearby to watch their kids when they go to the store or help them with childcare. They don't have that support system in place. So it creates a lot of problems. We see domestic violence increasing. We see some other stuff. That said, we're desperate. You know, the kids don't have the families don't have a place. There's no housing for them in San Francisco. And so, you know, I think the idea is better some housing than no housing. And even if it's out of town, that's better than nothing. But it's certainly not a panacea. And it is not a real commitment from the city to end homelessness, because the city needs to really commit to our families. That means permanently funding subsidies in San Francisco, creating housing where poor families in San Francisco can live, they can stay in their communities, and they have a subsidy that is going to address that disparity between income and rents permanently, and not have an 18-month cutoff, because, you know, getting out of poverty is not
well,
as
let's
easy.
Well, let's focus just a minute on the disparities. I mean, 20 individuals own as much wealth as half of the people of this country. That's about 350 million people.
Yeah.
I mean, no, I'm sorry. I'm thinking globally. That's about 150 million people,
uh-huh.
You know, or more, because it's about 300, it's over 300 million, about 330 million people in the country.
Right.
So half the country is about 150-something, right?
Yeah.
So 20 individuals own as much wealth as half the country.
Yeah.
So we see that that's an incredible disparity.
Yeah.
And add to that a stat I came across that said almost all of us could not come up with $500 in an emergency. We all live paycheck to paycheck, basically, you know, if we're not in the 1%.
Right.
We're living paycheck to paycheck, and we couldn't come up with, the statistic was 63%. I just remembered.
Yeah.
63% of us, more than half, well over half of us, could not come up with $500 in an emergency.
Right. It's really, you know, and I think that the interesting...
Which means if we get evicted and the rents are sky high, we're ass out.
Yeah. Yeah.
Period.
Right. And if you're, you know, if you have a situation where you have family who has a housing situation to fall back on, you know, one of the things with homelessness is that, you know, it's, you know, a very diverse population, but they do have in common a lack of access to accumulated wealth, severe poverty. You know, their family members are already living in overcrowded housing. You know, there's all these different situations. They have landlords that don't allow a lot of extra people living there.
Oh, tell me
about they're
it.
Not homeowners. They're not, you know what I mean? Like all these things that for poor folks. So, and you know, interesting thing about disparity, United States has highest income disparity in the Western world. And California has the highest income disparity in the United States, and San Francisco has the highest income disparity in California. And if you look at our income graph spread in the city of San Francisco, you know, back in the day it would have been a, you know, kind of a bell curve, right?
Uh-huh.
A little bit of rich, ultra rich, a little bit of ultra poor, and then everyone kind of in the middle. Well, that is flipped upside down.
Yeah.
So we have a U, and we have 27% extremely poor, you know, 27% extremely affluent, and very little in the middle. And so we have this huge income disparity in San Francisco that's, you know, pretty off the chain. We're a very rich city, you know, and if we had a serious commitment to ending homelessness, there would be a serious commitment to ensuring that we had progressive revenue, you know, tax the rich, get in some income. That is the serious thing that needs to be done to get that wealth and end homelessness. And there's no real commitment to doing that at all.
There's no will.
Yeah.
Because there's a will, there's a way, obviously.
Yeah. I mean, this administration went for, you know, a sales tax, to, you know, which failed, and, you know, which was a regressive tax. And, you know, we were desperate for money for homeless people. And so we can go along with it, but it ended up not passing. But, you know, what should have happened and what was recommended happening is they should have gone for a progressive revenue source, and that would have passed, like Proposition W did, which was a, you know, real estate transfer fee on mansions, and coming up with stuff like that. That's what San Francisco would support, and then we would have a revenue source to actually do the housing to end homelessness. But instead, nobody wants, you know, in the power elite wants to piss off their wealthy donors, and they go for the stuff that doesn't end up working.
It's mind-boggling. And then the other thing that's amazing is that they're spending $35 million annually already on the homeless.
Well, so higher than that. It's sort of it's like 100 and...
It's higher than that.
Yeah. The last controller's report was $170 million. They've added funding to that. But a large portion of that money, about $70 million, is going towards people who are already housed. So it's the ongoing operations of people in housing. And then the rest of it is, you know, the emergency shelter system, which is pretty bare bones and not very well funded. And you have some, you know, outreach teams. You have, you know, some other things. But it's, you know, it's in the grand scheme of things, we're spending only 2.5% of our budget on homelessness in San Francisco, 2.5%. So while the Chronicle likes to keep talking about how we're spending all this money and on homelessness, and I'm sure there's a little bit of waste in there, you know, I'm sure they got some, you know, overpaid bureaucrats and whatnot. But for the most part, in the grand scheme of things, we're not really seriously investing in homelessness. It's 2.5% of our budget.
Really? Yeah. I mean, investing in housing.
Yeah, in
we're
housing.
We're investing in homelessness.
Well, we're not, you know, in an emergency shelter, too. I mean, I think, you know, we've totally divested from that. We've lost a third of our shelter beds. We've lost half of our drop-in centers. So homeless people on the streets don't even have basic bathrooms, showers, you know, basic hygiene facilities. And I think that is leading, and I know it's leading to, you know, a complete disintegration of people's health. And, you know, they're living, you know, the life expectancy is a full 25 years shorter than people who are housed.
For goodness sakes, when we came over here to the studio today, it's pouring.
Yeah.
It's raining cats and dogs out there. I got soaked.
Yeah.
You know, might have noticed from my hair. but homeless people are out there being drenched.
Yeah.
And with no place to go, no shelter.
Right, exactly. And what that means for people, and, you know...
Of course it leads to illness.
Yeah. And there are so many illnesses. A lot of illnesses have an independent indicator. Homelessness is an independent indicator for a whole host of different illnesses. And some of them are more obvious, like, you know, homeless people are more likely to get pneumonia. You know, that's kind of an obvious one. They're also more likely to contract HIV/AIDS because their condoms get distributed, their property gets destroyed, you know, a whole host of things. And so if being forced to engage in survival sex, you know, all these different things. So getting out of a rainy night like this and what that means for folks. And so it's really, you know, they did a study at UCSF that basically said, you know, measured all these different things for a person who was homeless, their response time, their level of diabetes, heart disease, all these different things. And they found them to be 25 years older than their calendar year. So a 40-year-old homeless man tested at a 65-year-old level. And so it's, you know, this idea that people are choosing to be outside or choosing to be homeless is, you know, it's just not true. And it's really miserable for folks.
I don't know why people come up with that silliness. But I think it's a defense mechanism, and people don't want to have to deal with the problem, so they just decide to dismiss it.
Yeah, absolutely. And the politicians have been putting that in all of our collective psyches, right? Yeah. I mean, because that's why they don't want to be blamed for the homeless problems, so they blame it on the homeless people.
Right.
And so, oh, we offered them all this stuff, but they refuse. They're service resistant. They don't want any help. Yeah. That's why they're out there. There's something wrong with them, or they did wrong things, you know, all of that stuff. And that really feeds into letting the politicians off the hook, allowing them to have a criminal justice response. You know, last year we spent $20 million on a police response to homelessness. It achieved an increase in homelessness. So it was a big waste of money. We spent $20 million last year primarily on a police response to homelessness, on criminalizing homeless people. It cost us $20 million. So
to harass and hound and
move people a block away. Exactly.
Mess up the homeless.
Yeah, so we could have been spent on housing.
Trying to keep our language clean.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, so really frustrating. And that
$20 million to mess with the homeless.
Yeah, $20 million.
Instead of solving the problem.
Exactly, exactly. And you know, if I'm at home and you know, I'm there's a homeless person outside my home and I'm worried about them, I'm worried about their disintegrating health, or let's say I don't like the way they look and I want them gone, regardless, when I call the city, they're going to send a police in response. And that is our primary response to homelessness. And it's a problem, and it's a problem all over the country, but it's especially acute here in San Francisco, where homeless people have been used as political wedges time and time again. So they're used by politicians, they're used by folks running for office who want to drive more conservatives to the polls. They're used, and they're used in very much the same way Trump used immigrants and Muslims. Our conservative politicians here in San Francisco use homeless people. So this last election, we had Proposition Q, which is ripping the tents away from homeless people with the offer of one night in shelter. And they, you know, used all kinds of derogatory imagery and language to talk about the population and further demonize them. And basically, you know, did this because they wanted to draw more conservatives to the poll for Scott Wiener's campaign. They did this because Mark Farrell, the author of it, wants to run for mayor. So he's using it as like a controversial issue to get his face out there. So his picture appeared on all their mailers and, you know, trying to look mayoral standing in front of City Hall. Right. And it was a big failure for them, of course. And that's really wonderful that it failed for them. But the initiative passed, but only by 51.7. But in terms of them getting anywhere with that, it did not work as a political wedge, and they fell flat on their faces.
Right. Let's take a moment and share with our viewers this other video that we found that explains some of the. You got it ready, Jackie?
Homelessness all over the headlines this week, and this evening we are going to answer a question that many of you have been asking for years now. If San Francisco spends nearly $250 million on the homeless every year, why are there still thousands of people living on the street? Where does that money go, and how does the system work or not work? KPIX5's Wilson Walker takes it all apart for us.
It's the result of programs that are not really working, not working to anybody's satisfaction.
Well, it's hard to argue with that, but to better understand how this all works, let's start with that one big number, $241 million. Now, of that, $50 million funds shelters and another $50 million fund health services for the truly homeless. But the single most important thing to know about that $241 million is that most of it has absolutely nothing to do with the people we see on the streets.
That is a great observation. I think it's missed by many in the city. We're not spending $241 million a year on the 7,000 or 8,000 people who are homeless in San Francisco. We're spending more than half of that money, actually, to keep people in permanent housing.
That's right. $140 million worth of the entire homeless budget houses approximately 9,000 people. And those are 9,000 people we don't even count as homeless.
It's like all of our hotels, people who have lived in housing for 10 years are in the homeless budget. So people will say, well, we don't notice it. But if we didn't spend that money, you'd notice it because the numbers would be off the charts.
So that leaves us with the 6,686 people we do count as homeless, and they fall into two separate categories, those in some kind of temporary shelter and those who actually live on the street.
Our diagnosis and Feinstein were cool.
And two perfect examples of this walked right up to us while we were interviewing former Mayor Art Agnos. First is Lee, who might look like he lives on the street.
Well, I got a room.
And then there's Ron.
Why aren't you living in a room or of some kind now?
Well, I tried in North Beach, for example.
And at that point, we had some vintage impromptu Agnos.
I'll take you there.
Really? In Mission Street?
I'll take you to the Diagnostic Center.
And just like that, Ron was in the car with the former mayor and off to the Mission Neighborhood Resource Center. If you want a shelter bed in San Francisco, this is where you have to go, and you've got to be willing to play by the city's rules.
You have to do finger imaging and all this stuff to get an emergency shelter bed.
So a lot of people, like Richard here, make another choice.
So you choose not to go to the shelters?
Well, sure, partner. Come on, man.
Have you ever been in some of these places?
Clearly, we're not meeting the demands that people have on the streets.
Want to make this even more complicated? San Francisco manages all of this through at least 8 different city departments, issuing some 400 contracts with at least 75 private organizations. A tangled network of services with no unifying oversight by the city that actually hands out most of the money.
The one area where we have not done as good of a job as we need to is really coordinating all of those systems.
Here's one little scenario for you. A man with mental health challenges is staying in a nonprofit or a charity shelter until one day he voluntarily checks out, lands in some trouble, lands in the custody of law enforcement, who takes him to a hospital where he spends some time in a psych ward. Now, in each one of these 3 cases, it can be recorded as a by-the-book acceptable outcome, even though the guy is back out on the street, and the city has no single unified way of tracking any of this, as people simply ricochet between service providers.
And if you're a provider, it's difficult to know what other services that individual or families are receiving.
Then there's another immense challenge facing San Francisco. Even if we could convince all of these people to accept help, our best services do not scale to the overwhelming demand.
Navigation centers do a good job for those they serve, but the numbers are so small. You're talking about 50 people here. Come on, you're talking about a 6,000 person problem.
So how do we ever start to untangle all of this with results we can actually see?
That's a great question, and I think really the only way that we're going to change people's perception is by making progress.
Jennifer, your comments. We're back here on Freedom is a Constant Struggle with Jennifer Friedenbach of San Francisco's Coalition on Homelessness.
Well, I think, you know, and those numbers, the numbers that I quoted earlier were from the controller's report, and these are numbers that come out of the mayor's office. The proportions are the same. I think, you know, the mayor's, you know, we don't quote those because we're waiting to see an independent, you know, something from an official body, and, you know, often the stuff coming out of the mayor's office gets sort of blown up in a way. Or exaggerated so that they can show just how much they're doing for folks. And so, but in essence, I mean, that's, you know, the one of the main things that the new homeless department, and there's the creation of the new homeless department, was to try to address this coordination issue.
When was it created?
It was created this summer.
Yeah. It was very recent.
Yeah, okay. So it's really, the issue is that, I mean, we can coordinate services and we can track people better, absolutely. But the reality is, from the homeless person's perspective and from the service organization's perspective, is that all the services are overwhelmed. They're all over capacity. So that one program that they showed there, Mission Neighborhood Resource Center, where people can go to try to get shelter, and you know they have some health services and whatnot, they're contracted to serve 100 people a day. They have 350 people walking through their doors every day. And so, you know, if we can coordinate these services and track people, but no matter how smooth running the system is, it's not going to change anything if at the end of the day we don't have more housing for folks.
Right.
And that really needs to be the emphasis. The solution to homelessness, dun, 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 is housing. Exactly, if you have a home. And that doesn't mean that it's going to lift people out of poverty, and we have to continue to do stuff to make that happen. And, you know, address all those poverty abatement programs are really important, but it's not going to ensure people have access to mental health treatment. We got to make sure we have a decent mental health system and a decent substance abuse treatment system. But, you know, very hard to address employment issues, mental health issues, health issues, any of those issues if people remain on the streets getting traumatized day after day after day.
Yeah, how are you going to get a job if you don't have an address?
Yeah.
You can't even get a driver's license. And I learned that it's more important to have a driver's license than a high school diploma to get a job.
Right, yeah. Yeah, it's true.
So they're screwed any way you cut it.
Right.
You know, yeah. And it there has to be a way of solving the problem. And, of course, we know what that is.
Right.
One of the things I thought, I wanted to ask you, they talked on the video about San Francisco Homeless Project. What exactly is that?
The San Francisco Homeless Project was kind of the media blitz that took place over the summer, and then they just did one a couple weeks ago as well. It started off with the editor of the Chronicle wanting to, you know, the way it was described is sort of, you know, her daughter had seen somebody having sex in a tent or something like that, and, you know, it sort of raised a lot of the, you know, a lot of our eyebrows of, okay, so the media is going to come up with the solutions now to homelessness, like that's kind of... Come on now. And so, but in the end, I think that actually a lot of the media outlets, and you showed a couple of the pieces here, did a really good job, especially since they really included the voices of homeless people themselves. Right? And there was a forum show on Michael Krasny that had 100% homeless persons panel. There was, you know, a lot of really good interviews with homeless folks. And I think that, you know, there was a lot of good pieces really, really digging down, analyzing the issue, and a lot of education happened among the public, and I think that that was really helpful.
I heard that. One of the things I wanted to talk about was the national picture. And California, of course, has the dubious honor of being the largest homeless population, as we mentioned earlier, and the count is actually about 118,000 people. New York City is number one, 73,000. L.A., 43,000 people in L.A. I'm just going to read them down the line, the top 10. New York, L.A., Seattle, San Diego, Washington, D.C., San Francisco, San Jose, Boston. Where did this other sheet go? Oh, God, I hate that. Shuffling papers is not a good idea. Las Vegas, Philadelphia, Texas, Balance, I don't understand the Texas balance of state. What is that? Anyway, Chicago, Metropolitan Denver Homeless Initiative. I guess that's who gave up the statistics anyway. Mm. Oregon, Phoenix, Georgia, Washington, and Honolulu. Mm. I was really surprised to learn that Honolulu has a homeless population of 5,000.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think,
unbelievable.
Yeah, you know, we have this situation where the federal government divested from housing. You know, in 1983, they cut housing under Reagan by 74%. It actually started under Jimmy Carter with the neoliberal policies under Carter. This idea of cutting the social safety net and, you know, loosening up regulations. And they, you know, really, you know, so we had that major events happening. We had welfare reform under Clinton, which was a huge
welfare
hit. Yeah, we had with the Contract on America, we had the shifting of our economy to a service sector economy. We had, you know, we had all these things, bad decisions that were made on bad decisions on bad decisions. So it wasn't as if a million men, women, and children said, wouldn't it be cool to live outside? There was systemic forces and created the largest number of homeless people since the Great Depression. And we've never really gotten back to addressing that, trying to replace that budget to today's time. We've spent a lot of money on wars and, you know, a lot of
trillions
different things.
On war.
We give a lot of money on, you know, mortgage interest deductions. So that's our main housing policy is mortgage interest deductions in terms of money. And so it really, you know, has meant that the cities are left kind of holding the bag because traditionally our centers of poverty have been in our urban areas. That's changing, of course. Mm-hmm. There's so much displacement out of the cities. So now we're going to see this, you know, really high numbers of homelessness in the suburbs.
There are going to be pockets of poverty.
The Fergusons, the, you know, different areas like
that. Antiochs.
East Palo Alto, you know, different places. When we look at San Francisco is not different from other areas. The majority of homeless people in San Francisco became homeless as San Franciscans, 71%. And the small proportion of people who came to town homeless is the same proportion in all these other cities. All these cities think that they're a magnet. Every city in the country thinks they're a magnet for homeless people. Even when I was in San Mateo County, those little cities think that, yeah, because it lets them off the hook.
Exactly.
Las Vegas was sure that homeless people were coming there for the weather in the winter. People are sure that they're coming to San Francisco for mild weather. They're sure that they're coming to these places for our great services. So there's been all these different studies, and they just find it's just not true. And it's a small majority of homeless people who are moving, and the reasons are complicated, but it's the same immigration patterns as anywhere. People move for family and jobs. So there's some kind of connection. That's what gets them somewhere. You know, there's a very small percentage, like 1.3%, they're coming for services. So it's very, you know, kind of this mythology around homelessness has just permeated our collective psyche. And it's very difficult to buck. And it lets the policymakers off the hook because they say, well, if we do anything more, we'll just come. And that's how people think about it. But in fact, you know, when obviously poor folks don't have a lot of ability to move around. So, you know, you have to stay in your community. That's where your support system is. You know, you're relying on your folks to, you know, do the things that you need to do. You can borrow your aunt's shower. You can, you know, I mean, all this stuff that happens, and just getting up and moving to some random place. Some people do it. I'm not saying they don't, but it's not very common, and no one place has a higher proportion of folks that do that than other places. In fact, in San Francisco, of course, we're sending our poor people out of town, by and large.
I know.
We're not attracting poor people in. We're pushing them out.
Yeah. Absolutely. And yeah, we push black people out to the point where they're black population in San Francisco has been reduced, I heard recently, to about 3%.
Yeah. That's the current estimate. Yeah.
So, and of course, you know, they're now getting pushed out of Oakland because in Oakland, used to be predominantly black, but Oakland is second only to San Francisco now in high rent.
Yeah.
So, because people are being pushed from San Francisco to Oakland,
right,
and so the rents in Oakland are sky high.
Right.
And and there's a lot of gentrification going on there. You know, and I wanted to bring up the recent warehouse fire. And 36 people lost their lives, and largely because of the conditions of homelessness, of having to live in a space that was not safe. And since then, instead of trying to find better spaces or to assure that other warehouses spaces are safe, they're evicting people.
Right. Yeah, it's a big challenge because, yeah, I mean, it's part of the housing crisis.
Yeah.
And I think that was pointed out right away after the fire by, you know, by many people, that this is a direct result of our housing crisis, and now our housing crisis is killing people.
Yeah.
You know, the problem with the situation is that, you know, as soon as, you know, with those landlords of those buildings, as soon as they get, you know, the city gets wind of it and the city, you know, contacts them, a lot of times then the immediate reaction of landlords is just to evict all the people because they're living there illegally, right?
Right.
And so that happened at Lobot, and which was a large collective art space in Oakland, and they had a party there, fire department came in, contacted the landlord. The landlord said, okay, you guys all got to go. And so it's a really difficult situation to address because, of course, you want to make sure that the living conditions are safe. But at the same time, there's really no incentive for the landlords to do that. It's easier for them to just kick people out and rent to somebody else, turn it into condos or whatever.
I know. And one of the things, my last $64,000 question, of course, is, what do you think of Ben Carson as the new, the prospective head of HUD?
Yeah, it's
housing and urban development.
Yeah, well, you know,
I mean, this is, what's the budget? Something like, I don't know.
I don't even know what their budget is.
It's up in the billions, way up in the billions.
Well, I mean, so HUD's, they're in charge of a number of things. They're in charge of fair housing, and so making sure that there's not discrimination in housing. And I think that, you know, there's been a lot of attention paid to whether they're going to be taking that seriously or not, given the track record. And of course, they're responsible for public housing, and you know, one of the big problems that has happened, and one of the problems with having an ultra-conservative like Ben Carson take charge of it, is that there has been a very deliberate effort to starve public housing, let the conditions disintegrate to such an extent, and then spring in the bulldozers, privatize, turn the properties over, move them over from public to private entities. And I'm sure that'll be part of Ben Carson's agenda. And that is, of course, very, very problematic in terms of, you know, losing access to vital housing stock for the very poorest residents of our country. And there's a lot of things that he can do that would really be really, you know, put public housing residents in a lot of jeopardy.
So he can exacerbate the problem of homelessness and
houselessness.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, you know, there's a lot of folks and, you know, I mean, the starving of public housing and letting the conditions get so decrepit and, you know, is a driver of homelessness. And, you know, people who, you know, can't, you know, they're trying to get an emergency transfer because, you know, some kind of situation is happening. You know, we had a woman that was living in public housing that was getting raped and she was trying to get a transfer and couldn't do it. And, you know, I mean, there's all these different things that have very real impacts on people's lives that all have altogether to do with whether the housing authorities are properly funded to manage those properties. But when they starve them, you know, you can't respond to these things. When someone moves out of a unit, you can't turn it over. You can only put a board on the window. And then you're ending up creating the lack of safety for people who are left there because you have a bunch of vacant units. And then that creates problems of its own.
Right.
You have,
1 minute.
Yeah, you know, you have a whole host of problems. And so the public housing in HUD is the key to ending homelessness. And, you know, I highly doubt Ben Carson has a commitment to ending homelessness.
Yeah, so folks, we have our work cut out for us. It's not time to be fearful. It's time to pull ourselves together and fight back.
Absolutely.
Absolutely fight back.
Yeah.
So,
and folks can go on our website, cohsf.org, get on our mailing list.
And buy the street sheet.
And buy street sheet. Stay informed on street sheet.
Right. And yeah. Thank you so much, Jennifer Friedenbach of the San Francisco Homeless Coalition, the executive director. Thank you so much for joining us on Freedom. And thank you, Jackie Perez, for a usually great job. And thank you, viewers, for tuning in to Freedom is a